Hello. Yes, I'm keeping this part of the title, Philosophy of Biology, because biological phenomena cannot be explained through basic principles in the physicalist sciences, and that is what philosophy of science does. So a new philosophy of biology is necessary, and Ernst Mayr has written a good book about that, what makes biology unique. Biology is a science. It is younger than the physicalist sciences, physics, chemistry. But as Ernst Mayr says in his book, it took 200 years and three sets of events before biology was recognized as an autonomous science. And those three sets of events, as I mentioned in the previous video, but I will repeat it, it is important, have been, one, the refutation of some erroneous principles, vitalism and teleology. The second set of events was the demonstration that basic principles in the physicalist sciences are not applicable to the living world. And the third set of events is that the realization that in biology there are some basic principles that are inapplicable to the inanimate world. Anyway, teleology today. Many psychologists, Paul Bloom is one of them, have written that for very small children it is natural for them to seek purpose in natural phenomena. For example, they may say that why there is a breeze, because so that it makes the branches of a tree sway beautifully. Why is the lion as it is, so that we can enjoy watching him in the zoo, and so on. But that is not unnatural, seeing that primitive man was aware that he himself has a purpose, has the capacity for planning, goal-directing activity. And also making, producing things like tools, shelter, clothes, and so on. And also when agriculture came to have this goal-directed activity of growing up food. So that primitive man, that was very important to him, and he realized that he has a purpose, but not only that he himself has a purpose, but that other people have purpose, the capacity to have goals, to plan and achieve those goals, or to make, produce things. Because man is a very social animal. The human species is a very, very social species. One man, a man individual, an isolated man will not survive, but even if he can, as Daniel Defoe did, for reproduction, one needs, people need other people. So, yeah, people lived among other people, and the struggle for life, as Darwin has expressed himself in Origin of Species, is not only against other species or natural phenomena, but against members of one's own species, against other people. And that is why it was a good adaptation that people had the capacity to know that other people also have minds, that other people have thoughts and can plan things and so on. And in ancient Greek philosophy, Plato, for example, who was very influential, he had a model of the world, which was entirely different from the world as we see it. The real world to him was not as what we witness. And for him, observation, testing was not important for finding explanations of the world, but thinking. And in this way, he impeded the development of science a lot. Just after him, Aristotle, who is the father of Western philosophy, with hindsight now, we can say that also he set back the development of science a lot, because he took in mind, he paid a little bit more attention than Plato to observation, but considered that observation and thinking, both ways, can lead to finding explanation of things. But he impeded the growth of science because he paid attention to teleological causation and not to natural causation. So teleology is very normal, all this. So all that I said until now shows that teleology is very normal thinking and is very often part from the common sense of people. The epistemology of the word is telos, end point or end goal. Ernst Mayr makes a distinction between these two words. End point is different than end goal. For example, a river that is flowing, the end point is it flows into the ocean, but that is not an end goal, while in mostly in the biological world there is an end goal of processes. So yes, Ernst Mayr has a very good philosophy in his book, What Makes Biology Unique. It is very important, a very good philosophy, because he tries to use words and corrects the general use of some words. For example, the word function has, as he says, in the biological world, two different meanings. One is a physiological function, and the other one is a faculty that plays a role in the life cycle of a living organism. Also, I mentioned the distinction between the two meanings of telos, end point, and terminus, or end goal. Also, Ernst Mayr makes it clear that till you talk about teleology, this term teleology has five different characteristics, five different kinds. I mentioned them in the previous video, but I will say them again. There are processes that are teleomatic processes, and I will explain them when I, or first I will enumerate them. Teleomatic processes, teleonomic processes, purposive behavior, adaptiveness, and cosmic teleology. Let's take them separately. Teleomatic processes are processes which, yes, they have an end point, not a goal, and point, for example, what is the telos of a rainstorm? When the rain stops, and that is the end point of a rainstorm. This is a teleomatic process. If you have in mind that it has a terminus, an end point. A river flows and goes into the ocean, that is also a teleomatic process. Teleomatic process describes the movement and change in the inanimate world under the influence of natural laws, of natural forces. The second, teleomatic processes, and that is a big topic. So to explain the goal-directed activity in the living world, this is a good term, teleonomic processes, apparently Patendry introduced this term in 1958, and Ernst Mayr gives his definition of a teleonomic process.
Various authors used the term teleonomic either for programmed functions or for adaptedness. Mayr restricts the term teleonomic to programmed activities and provides the following definition. A teleonomic process or behavior is one that owes its goal-directedness to the influence of an evolved program. The term teleonomic thus implies goal direction of a process or activity. It deals strictly with ultimate causations. They occur in cellular developmental processes and are most conspicuous in the behavior of organisms. Goal-directed behavior is extremely widespread in the organic world. For instance, most activities connected with migration, food-getting, courtship, ontogeny, and all phases of reproduction are characterized by such goal orientation. The occurrence of goal-directed processes is perhaps the most characteristic feature of the world of living organisms. It is sometimes stated that Patendry and Mayr introduced the term teleonomic as a substitute for the term teleological. This is not correct. Rather, it is a term for only one of the five different meanings of the highly heterogeneous term teleological.
So the goal-directed activity behavior of a living organism is the reason for that behavior is evolutionary program that living organisms have, and this is a program that directs the activity of the organism or parts of the organism, like in the cell, for example. There is also goal-directed activity. This program is not only a set of activity, but instructions of the activity of the organism. Programs in the organism are not all only directed by DNA. DNA is the cause of the evolutionary creating of the through evolution of these programs, but the activity itself of the organism is not at this moment directed by the DNA, but already created programs, and the end goal of this activity is already present in the program, and also instructions of the activities that have to be done to achieve this goal. A study of teleonomic programs has shown that there are different kinds of such programs. One is closed programs, and that is well, the instructions of the programs are followed, and that's it. An open program is that one that depends on feedback and is open to the environment. For example, the program of the following of a gosling, when it is hatched, the first thing it sees is his mother and follows her everywhere. This is an open program because it is open to the environment, and sometimes the first thing that a gosling sees may not be his mother, but a person or a dog or something like that. And also there are somatic programs that has to do with through development, learn. It has to do with learning, memory, memorizing, and so on. And the third was purposive behavior, that is activity of thinking organisms, humans, who can form a purpose and make planning and achieve activities. For adaptive features, past mistake is to assign the appearance of adaptations to some teleological force. And this was said in natural theology. Explanations of this sort were given in this natural theology. One good example of that is William Paley, who explained complex the complexity of living organisms by teleology, saying that when a person sees a watch, for example, you will not think that natural forces have formed this watch, but you will see a design, and who makes a design? Intelligence, people, but some intelligence must have designed and created living organisms, like humans, for example. And all this teleology has been utterly demolished by Richard Dawkins in his book The Blind Watchmaker. The fifth characteristic is cosmic teleology. So already by the 19th century, when it was realized that the world is neither recent nor constant, unchanging, it was realized that the world is constantly changing. The geology, geological discoveries at the time, and also the changes in living organisms, it was realized that the world is constantly changing. They tried to find explanation for this. One explanation was that there is intrinsic, inside, inner, striving tendencies, force in the world, and that's what changes, provides the changes in the world, and that is again teleological. The second explanation was that there is a person, supernatural person, who directs all the changes, and the third explanation was that no such cosmic teleology exists, but the world is changing under the influence of physical, natural laws. So the concept of cosmic teleology is empty, and all the other characteristics of teleology, the changes there, received materialistic, naturalistic explanations. So there was no place for teleology anymore, except in teleonomic processes. That is what, but it is misleading, confusing to call that teleological. So I think we should read books like that, and there are many other books written by scientists for the lay public, so that we are not scientifically illiterate. And I'm sorry to see that there are scientifically illiterate people who demonstrate that when they give lectures to audiences, and those are presumably some of them educated people. Philip Johnson is one example, and then Berlinski, and there are others. I discovered them lately when I got interested in philosophy of biology. I will continue the following video. I will continue with the other two sets of events that happened before biology was and should be recognized as a major science. Bye.